church, and that was Leo Welchel. This last week was his birthday, and we've had these flowers up here for the last 2 weeks in honor of him. There's no words to describe the difference you can make in someone's life. When you dedicate your life to doing God's work in God's way, even cutting grass can touch people's lives. And that's what Mr. Leo did. He wasn't one to be up here on the stage and get all the fanfare, but he did so much around the church. We honor him today and what he's done. Open your Bibles to Genesis. We're in Genesis chapter 15 in our series on Abraham this week. Genesis chapter 15. When it comes to your reputation, when it comes to having something said about you whenever you're gone, what is it that you'd like for people to say? For Abram, who becomes Abraham, he is the only one in Scripture, Christian, the only one you will find recorded where in Isaiah chapter 41, verse 8, Abraham is called my friend by God. The only one. David was a man after his own heart, but he was not called God's friend. Abraham was called my friend. And when you think about friends, I think about friends that I've had. I think about some of my best friends. I think about friends that I have now that are so dear to my heart that I love to be around. I love to have conversations with. And when you think about a friend in your life, think about your best friend. What do you normally like to do? You like to spend time with them, right? John, you love to spend time with Danielle, right? Not because she's your fiancée, it's because she's your best friend. She's somebody you can hang out with and talk with, and it's good to have conversation. You know, we come to a chapter in Genesis where we're going to get a glimpse. We're going to be a fly on the wall. Have you ever said that? Boy, I wish I could be a fly on the wall. You know, I wish I could be a fly on the wall in that meeting or in that conversation or get to see this or get to see that. Well, we are going to be a fly on the wall in chapter 15 today whenever God and Abram have a conversation. This is quite remarkable, and I want to begin just walking us through this entire chapter, but I want us to begin in verse 1 right now. It says, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, do not fear, Abram. I am a shield to you. Your reward shall be very great. I want us to notice the first three words in this very first part of this chapter. After these things. Let us ask this question, after what things? After Abram, at the age of 75, is asked by God in a land where it's really pagan, where there isn't scripture and there's not a growing up in the faith, God comes to Abram and says, Abram, I need you to pack up your stuff, get your wife, and move. He's at 75 years old. And so he begins to obey God, but we know by just looking at that just a few weeks ago that Abram didn't fully obey God because he took his father with him and he took his nephew with him. And then Abram had to actually stop along the journey because his father had to pass away for him to continue the journey into the land of Canaan. And we also know that once he gets there, he makes a mistake. He actually, when he finds himself in a famine, he tries to fix it himself. Any guys in here like to do that? We had a confession that Sunday. We like to fix things, don't we? And so he wanted to fix it. Let's go to Egypt and you tell Pharaoh you're my sister and we'll get the enough that we need. We're going to survive this. And God brings a plague on Pharaoh's house and it kind of foreshadows what's going to happen. Did you notice that in that story, how it foreshadows exactly what happens? There's this plague that comes on Pharaoh's house. Pharaoh realizes, I need to let you go, and he says, get out of here. That's a foreshadowing of what's going to happen. But Abram is blessed through that by God's grace, and we see that he actually, I think he learns his lesson, because he goes back, and he goes back into the area that's got the famine, but he continues on and goes to the altar and calls on the Lord. Lot comes along. After this, Lot comes along, and he and Lot and Abram's men are fighting and bickering, and so Lot's and Abram decide, we need to part ways. And Abram says, you pick the left, I'll go to the right. You pick the right, I'll go to the left. When Abram could have said, I'm going this way, you go that way, or you go find your own place. You just get out of here. But he didn't. He had spent time with the Lord, and he Ask Lot to just pick. Well, we know after those things that Lot is captured by this king, Chedorlaomer, who comes and he wreaks havoc in the area. And Abram then gets his men together and go. And we looked at this last week, and he went and he rescued Lot and brought all the goods back. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Abram did not have the Bible. He did not have scripture. He didn't even have the Ten Commandments. He did not have any scrolls. All he had was his relationship with God Almighty as it was being revealed to him as he was walking with him. And so I know many of you would love for God to come to you in a vision and give you some direction in your life. Amen. Come on, somebody in here would love for God to just give you a vision and say, here's what you need to do. Can I tell you something? He's already written it down. He's written it down for you. Our problem is sometimes we don't want to look for it. We want it easy, don't we? We want God to work like Google. We want to pull God up like Google and say, God, I need to know what I need to do in this situation, and expect there to be an immediate answer from God, when God sometimes, he's got something bigger and greater for us to find. We see, after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision saying, do not fear, Abram. I am a shield to you. Your reward shall be very great. I don't know about you, but I'd love to have a relationship with God where we just carried on a conversation like that. There was a great pastor who put it this way. He said, prayer is when we talk to God. Scripture is when God talks to us. We often want God to answer us, and we need to be in his word to hear what he has to say. But as we look at this today, we can see God's word coming to him through this vision. And Abram said to God in verse 2, after God has said, your reward shall be very great. Man, wouldn't you love for God to tell you that, Mr. Eddie? God comes to you, Mr. Eddie, and says, Mr. Eddie, I am a shield to you. Your reward shall be great. That'd be wonderful. But look at what Abram says. He says, O Lord God, which is very unique because there's two words put there for God. O Lord God, what will you give me since I am childless and the heir of my house is Eliezer of Damascus? In other words, Abram is saying, look, you've made me a promise, God, but you ain't been delivering. You're saying you're going to do these great things, but there's not any indication it's going to happen. Have you ever been in that place where you feel like God's going to do something, but it seems like he's doing nothing? It seems like it's quiet. We see Abram here asking a question. And what I want us to do is I want us to look at God as our friend. God is our friend because if God was Abram's friend, can I tell you today that God is your friend and he's my friend? We can learn some things about God in this story that can apply to our life as we look at it on this side of the cross. Because Jesus is our connection so that God can be our friend. And the first thing is this, that God wants to calm our fears and he understands our questions. Do you see that in verse 1 where he says, do not fear, Abram? He wants to calm those fears. And then Abram comes back and he doesn't say, okay, fine, all right. He asks a question. He says, oh Lord God, what will you give me since I'm childless and the heir of my house of Eleazar of Damascus? Are you going to change the promise? Are you going to do something else? Abram's got questions, even though God has tried to calm his fears. And here's what I love, is I want you to see how God interacts with him. Because at this point, what is Abram focused on? He's focused on the promise. He's focused on what God has said. How do we know that? Look at how God responds. And Abram said, since you have given no offspring to me, one born in my house is my heir. Then behold, the word of the Lord came to him in verse 4 saying, this man will not be your heir, but one who will come forth from your own body, he shall be your heir. We all in here have it in English. We don't see the Hebrew. In the actual Hebrew, whenever there was a stress of a word, it would normally be put at the very front of the sentence. And in Hebrew, the word that is put at the very front of this sentence of what the Lord says is the word not or no. So Abram comes to God and he says, God, what are you going to give me? I don't have a child. Eleazar is going to have to be my heir. And in Hebrew, this is how God responds. No! No! There is an exclamation point God makes. No, Eleazar is not going to be your heir. But you're going to have an heir from your own loins. Your own DNA will carry this on. And so God is making an emphatic statement here. See, we know that God will calm our fears and He understands our questions because we see Abram here. He's asking this question. And so the Lord takes him in verse 5 and He says, and He took him outside and He said, now look toward the heavens and count the stars if you are able to count them. Now, here's what's fascinating about this. Something that I realized just this week. I've always heard this story as God took Abram outside when it was what? Light or dark? Dark. We've always heard He went outside when it was dark, correct? And He went outside and He looked up and He saw all the stars in the heaven and He started counting. 1,256,283. 2,956,284. Oh, I lost count. I got to start over. 1, 2. We've always thought of Abram trying to do that, right? But when we look at this story, I want you to notice something. This was fascinating to me. Verse 12, it says, now when the sun was going down. All right? Now, as we look through this in verse 17, it came about when the sun had set. Now, I submit to you, when God took Abram outside and said, look up into the heavens and count the stars, the sun was up. Now, this morning, if we walked outside to look at the stars, are we able to see them? Are the stars gone? They're still there, aren't they? Now, I want you to think about this. God is saying you cannot see the stars to even count them, but they're there. Let me take you to something even farther than that. Do you understand that at the speed of light, it's 186,000 miles per second? And if we were to travel right now, if this building just picked up and traveled the speed of light, we would all reach the moon that we can see at night in 1.3 seconds. Boom, we'd be on the moon. That would be pretty cool. I mean, there we are at the moon looking back at the earth. I think it'd be cool. If we continued to travel at that speed, we would reach the very first star in 4 years. 4 years traveling at 186,000 miles per second, we would reach the first star. How great is our God? Even though Abram went outside and he looked up and he couldn't even see all the stars. Maybe there was a star here and there's a star over there. But here's the point I think God was making. Abram, you cannot even see the stars, but yet I hung them where they are. See, over in Genesis chapter 1, verse 16, there are two Hebrew words that simply says stars also. Because it says over in Genesis chapter 1, verse 16, this is one of my favorite of God's awesomeness in all of Scripture to me. God made the two great lights, the greater light to govern the day, which is what? The sun. The lesser light to govern the night, which is what? The moon. And it says, He made the stars also. Let's just kind of drop that in there. Do you understand? We can't even count the number of stars, much less the galaxies and the universes. And if we were to right now take, let's say we were going to do a model of just our universe, the sun and the planets. And we were to take a 2-foot diameter, and let's say that's the sun, and put it right here on this stage. A 2-foot diameter ball, and let's call that the sun. And we're going to keep everything at its right ratios and distance and sizes. If we went out this door, we would have to travel 164 feet, put down a mustard seed, and that would be Mercury. If we traveled 120 more feet down the road, we could drop a BB, that would be Venus. If we traveled 156 more feet down the road, we could drop a green pea, and that would be Earth. Sounds pretty impressive, doesn't it? Hold on. If we traveled 216 feet beyond the green pea, and we dropped a pinhead, that would be Mars. Now hold on. think we're doing pretty good traveling several hundred feet. Man, we're several hundred feet down the road toward the interstate now, aren't we? You'd have to go 1,576 feet and drop an orange for Jupiter from this stage to grasp the vastness of how big our universe is that God created. We'd have to go 1,868 more feet, drop a golf ball on the golf course, and that would be Saturn. And then, if you go 4,172 more feet beyond that and drop a marble, that would be Uranus. And then 4,600 more feet, drop a cherry, that would be Neptune. Do you understand? That's like 2.5 miles, and we ain't even got to Pluto yet. If the sun was the size of a 2-foot ball and we marked it out, how great is our God? He says, Abram, just look up, dude. Look up into the sky. If he could not see the stars, God was saying, you may not see what I can see and what I got in my hand, but I'm in control and you're not. See, what God was doing to Abram was this: get your mind off the promise and get it on me. Did you hear that? I think that's pretty good. Get your mind off the promise and get it more on me. That's what Abram was doing. You need to see just how vast and great our God is. If we were to take this same model and go to the nearest star, remember it's four years for us traveling the speed of light to get to? If we were to have a 2-foot ball right here of the sun and we were to travel to the nearest star, do you understand? From right here, it would be 6,720 miles away. Our God is great. That the Word of God would just simply say, He made the stars also, like it was nothing. Can I tell you something? If my God can do that, it doesn't matter how big you think your problem is, it's pretty tiny to Him. It doesn't matter how you think He may not be speaking or you may not be able to hear Him. My God is greater than anything happening in your life right now. My God is great. And as we look at this, God was simply saying to Abram, I'm God and you're not. I've got this. I've got your back. I'm so glad that the third thing about God is this, is He wants us to live without improper fear. And I want to say improper fear because a fear of the Lord is good. It brings wisdom. A fear of the Lord is the right kind of fear to have. And we can see that God in verse 1 says, do not fear, Abram. And then in verse 12 and 13, now when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and behold, has anybody been here? Terror and great darkness fell upon him. Abram understood what it was to be scared. And then God says to Abram, know for certain, don't doubt. Get it that what I say is going to happen. And He gives him a glimpse of not just a generic revelation of you're going to be the father of great nations and you're going to have all these descendants. And yeah, you may be outside. You may not be able to see the stars, but I do see the stars. I know how many stars are up here. You can't even count them right now. You can't see them. God could have said, look at the wheat, look at the sand, look at the grains of the dirt under your feet, count the little small pebbles. God could have said anything, but He said, look at the stars. I believe God did that so that Abram would go, I can't see all of them, to realize, but God can. To give him a comfort, to help him with that fear. But here in verse 12, this terror and this great darkness, and God says, not only are you going to have great nations and great descendants, but there's going to be difficulty coming to their life. And He tells them about how they're going to be put into slavery, and after 400 years they're going to be led out. That's the Exodus. That's the whole story that's going to come up in Genesis of Joseph and how his family comes to Egypt and they hang out there because of a famine, and then the great deliverance under Moses. Moses isn't even born. Moses hasn't even Abraham's son's not even been thought of yet. And God is going, I got this. I know what's going to happen. How great is our God? And what He does is really unique. God actually tells him about the land that he would possess, not only are you going to have descendants, you're going to have property. And Abram says, well, how can I know for sure? Abram had questions. And God's okay with questions. It's okay to ask him any question you have. But here's what I find powerful. God says, I want you to get something for me. He says, I want you to go in verse 9, bring me a 3-year-old heifer, a 3-year-old female goat, and a 3-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a young pigeon. And what he does is what's called a covenant, a cutting of the covenant, where he actually cut the animals. Abram cut the animals in half. He cut the heifer, he cut the goat, and he cut the ram in half. And what would happen is, let's say that I was going to make a covenant with Buddy today. Buddy and I would take an animal and we'd cut it in half. Both of us would walk through that animal and we would be declaring to all of you that if either one of us breaks the covenant, what has happened to these animals, shall it happen to me? Shall death be my end if I break this covenant? When you read this story, this is what's really cool, isn't it, John? That as Abram is asleep, and as God wakes him up, and as he's looking, and he's having these visions, and he is looking, in verse 17, then it came about when the sun had set that it was dark, and behold, there appeared a smoking oven and a flaming torch which passed between these pieces. God passed between the two animals that had been cut apart, saying, I rectify, seal this covenant. You will not read where Abram passed through the animals. Why? Because the responsibility of the fulfillment of the promise of God is not Abram, but God himself. God said, I'll take it upon me all alone to fulfill this promise which I am making to you. See, our God is great. And it foreshadows that God is taking it upon himself, the promise that we will be rectified with him. And that's why Jesus left heaven and came to earth to die on a cross for you and I, so that promise would be fulfilled. God took it completely upon himself to fulfill it and make it come to pass. So not only does he calm our fears and understands our questions and knows when to bless us and when to delay, he wants us to live without improper fear. But also, he has plans for our good and not our destruction. See, we have to trust him in the darkest moments that he's got this. Whenever it seems like we're covered, as Abram was, with terror and great darkness falls upon us, God's got this. The Bible says to trust in him with all of our heart and lean not on our own understanding, but in all our ways acknowledge him and he will direct our path. But we still have to make a choice, right, Mr. Lynn? Even with that, we still have to choose at the end of the day. So as we know that our future is as clear to God as our past is to us, our God is great. See, everything that's happened to us, we can think about it and we know it. God already knows what's going to happen. He knows what's going to happen tomorrow. He knows what's going to come up. He knows exactly what you're thinking right now. But my God, in all his knowledge, still sees value and has great plans for all of us to make a difference in this world for Jesus Christ. As we do this, our faith focus must be focused on the right thing. See, we have to be careful not to place our faith on circumstances, because faith placed on circumstances it's only circumstantial. Based on what the circumstances are and what they do and how they change and where they go will determine your faith. Man, I got faith. You're going to do great things in this world. If my faith is truly in someone to do great things in this world and they don't do great things, what's going to happen to my faith? It's going to crumble. If I have faith that, man, my job is going to get me to the next level in life, and my job goes away, my faith will go away. But here's the beauty. See, Abram's idea was his faith was focused on the promise to start with. And then God brought him into a into this conversation and into this moment where he began to look beyond the promise of what God said, and he started looking at the promise maker. Because see, when your faith is based on the promise maker, then your faith is rock solid. See, we have to be careful not to hold so tightly to the promises of God's word that they become an idol. Hold on, Pastor. Are you telling me that God's word, the promises of his word, can become an idol? Absolutely. How is that? When we hold so tightly to what's in these pages rather than the one who wrote the pages, then this has become an idol in our life. And God will have to strip it away until he becomes the only God. And when we're only looking at the promise maker, then the promise maker can take his promises and keep them in our life. Because then we're not looking for the results, the greatness to be in the results, but in God himself. So today I encourage you with this. Be careful not to hold on to the promises so tight you miss the promise maker, the one who's made the promises. Abram's going through a great conversation here. How great it is, how I wish my conversations with God went back and forth like this. But I don't know if I could handle it sometimes. As we're looking at this, what must we do? Well, when I look at this story, Abram, I don't see him with a whole bunch of other people. When I read through this conversation in chapter 15, it's not him and Sarai, it's not him and Eleazar, it is him and God. So let me tell you, the greatest way to help turn your heart and your mind to grab hold of that deep friendship with God is to get alone with God. And I'm going to say it again, I've said it before. Getting alone with God behind the steering wheel of your car while you're going down the road is not getting alone with God. Because you're going to get distracted by all the other drivers and where you're supposed to turn and what you're supposed to do, and you're not going to be able to concentrate. Let me ask a question. Those of you who are married in the room, how well does it go, Scott, when your wife is having a conversation with you, your eyes is turned somewhere else and you're reacting to stuff on TV? How well does that go, buddy? When Lisa's trying to talk to you and you're focused on something on TV and she's saying something and you're responding to stuff on TV how well does that go in marriage? Anybody want to tell us how well that goes? Doesn't go so hot, does it? It doesn't go very well. For those of you who are engaged, that's not a good way to have a great marriage. When you have a conversation with your wife, have a conversation with your wife. Don't be distracted. We don't like people to do that in our life. Why do you think God's okay with it? He wants to talk to you. He wants to reveal things to you. He wants to be your friend. But our problem is we're so busy with all the other stuff in our life. Getting alone with God is, I just don't have time. You can find time for that which you deem important. That's right. Number two, tell him my fears and ask him my questions. Here's the challenge this week for you. When you, and I'm saying when, not if, when you get alone with God this week, I want you to spend some time telling him all your fears. I want you to just think of fears and say, God, I'm afraid of this, I'm afraid of that, and I'm afraid this is going to happen, and I'm afraid of that's over here. I've been waiting on an answer here, and it just seems to be delayed. And can I tell you, a delay does not mean it's a cancellation of what God has for you. A delay just means it's a delay. It's still coming. It's like Christmas is still coming. Praise God, hallelujah, we're going to start singing Christmas music in a month. Amen. Amen. In my house we do anyway. Christmas is coming, but Christmas isn't here. Your promise is coming. It's just not here right now. And so when you talk to him about your fears, ask him your questions. That's what Abram did. Abram talked about his fears. He asked the questions. God's okay with that. God is not going to be up there. God's not going to be up there listening to you. And you bring up something and God go, oh, golly, I can't believe he said that. He's not going to do that. He already knows. And what happens is as we tell him our fears and we ask him our questions, we're taking that out of us and laying it at his feet. And the last thing is this, expect an answer from Him. Expect God to answer you when you call. Because, see, my God is everywhere. He's all-powerful. He can hear my prayers at any moment. There is nothing that limits my God except for this. He cannot lie, Scripture says. God cannot lie. And if God has said things in Scriptures about me, knowing Jesus Christ, then I need to take those to the bank. I want to read you a quote that was written by Peggy Noonan in a book called When Character Was King about Ronald Reagan. Ronald Reagan's daughter was doing part of this bibliography, and she was being interviewed anyway for this particular book called When Character Was King. It's a great book that I'm going to get, and I'm going to actually read it when I came across this. I'd love to read When Character Is King about Ronald Reagan. But this is what Ronald Reagan's daughter said about him. She said, "A lot of things he taught me as a child I didn't reject, but I didn't take them on big time until I got much older." Can somebody say amen about that? Man, that is so true. He did have something special with God. He talked to God all the time. It didn't mean that he was any more special in God's eyes or that he believed that. We all are special with God. It's not that God's speaking to anybody more than anyone else. It's that some people choose to listen and talk back. And my father talked to God. That's what I got as a child. I got that he just talked to God all the time. He just had conversations with God. When we'd go horseback riding at the Malibu Ranch, just the two of us, I knew the way to get him to talk and to have a conversation was to talk about God. And talk about heaven. Ask him about heaven. What do you think God thinks of this? What do you think heaven is like? If I went to that place, we would have these wonderful conversations. And he would just tell me sometimes, "Well, I asked God about this, and this is what he said back to me." My father told me that my whole life. You ask God something, and he will answer you. He will answer very specifically. Might not be the answer you want to hear, but God will give you an answer. That's why my father felt confidence about the big decisions in his life. So I want to encourage you with this today. What do people say about you? Where are you in your walk? When you get alone with God, do you have a conversation with God? Do you share your fears? Do you share your questions? Do you spend time with Him? Because I got news for you. God is our friend. He wants to calm your fears. He wants to understand your questions. He knows when to bless us, and He knows when to delay. Abram, 10 years earlier, was told to leave Ur of the Chaldeans, and he would receive the land as an inheritance. He's waited 10 years. He's now 85. And as we will find out, he will have to wait many years more. God delays sometimes for our good, because sometimes when we get the good things, he knows we won't know how to handle them. He wants us to live with the proper fear of him. Not fear of man, not fear of our circumstances. He's got good plans for you and I. When we keep our eyes focused on the promise maker more than the promises that he's made. Will you bow your heads and pray with me? Father, we thank you for your word this morning. We thank you for Abram. We thank you for his story. This conversation where we could be a fly on the wall today to see how you were talking to your friend. Thank you, Father, that it was written down so that we can see how you cared for him, how you want to calm his fears, you want to calm ours. We are your friend. We are a friend of God. Lord, it doesn't degrade you and bring you down to just being human to say you're our friend. It brings you to a point of compassion and love for us. Thank you. Father, today, if someone here has not received you as their Savior, Lord, today's the day. Today's the day for them to begin that relationship that is not measured by how well they clean up their life, what good they do, what bad they don't, but it's measured by them simply surrendering their life to you, asking you to forgive them and take over their life. May they do that today, Father. May they not be able to leave this room without dealing with that. Lord, for those who are dealing with sin, who have hidden sins in their life, God, may you shake their soul to to the very essence of their being, that they cannot sleep until they handle it. Father, we pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. If today you would like to come and you would like to, for me to pray with you, if you need to come today and join the church, if you need to come today and simply just say, would you pray with me, Pastor? Would you pray for this? Would you pray for that? Would you please come as we stand and sing? Chicopee. God has brought to us a wonderful family, the Garrett family, Brandon and Camille, his wife, then Mia and Anna and Bradley. They are a serving family. Get this, Bradley has been in the tech booth today with my son doing the online streaming. Anna sang up here, Mia works around the church, and Brandon and Camille, they're involved in the youth. This is an awesome family. We are so honored. And Y'all have a fan right over there, I think. So we're glad to have them here at Chicopee Baptist Church. Everyone who's in favor of this family being part of our family, making the commitment that this is their home, would you say hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise the Lord for that. We're excited to have them. Looking forward to hearing more from them. And we're thankful that you are here today. If you have any questions for me, if you would like to talk with me or pray with me after the service, I'll be right back here. To my right of these doors as you're going out. And we're thankful that all of you have come today to worship God here. And here it is. Here's the microphone. All right. Good deal. Brandon, I'd love for you to dismiss us in prayer today, my friend. Go ahead.
Let us pray. Our most kind, gracious, and heavenly Father, God, we thank you.
We thank you again, God, for all your many blessings, God. We thank you for this message this morning. I pray, God, that you would make it applicable to our lives, God. I pray, God, that we would apply it. I thank you, God, for this church, God. I thank you, God, for the opportunity to serve you, God, in the capacities that my family gets to serve together, God, here. God, I thank you for Pastor Clyde, God, and I thank you for this body. I pray, God, that you would give us traveling mercies, God, as we depart. And I pray, God, that you would just watch over us, God. Help us, Lord God, to be Jesus to each other. And God, help us, Lord God, to be Jesus to this lost and dying world out these doors. In your most holy and precious name we do pray. Amen.